I start not just with the building. I talk about the bigger picture of water issues in Texas. And you're going to hear a couple of words that I repeat during the presentation. And I think those words really signify what an operation like this can be. It's stewardship and partnership. Of course, stewardship, as we all know, and especially people that come to presentations like this, are already practicing some type of stewardship, maybe of the environment around your home or your community. And then partnership. When we're looking at resources, especially water, energy, and infrastructure of resources, in order to sustain that for the future, these partnerships are very important. And the John Bunker Sands Wetland Center was built as a partnership, especially for water. The building that you see here is actually sitting in the middle of a 2,000-acre man-made wetland that supplements your water supply this past summer by 25%. If the man-made wetland did not exist this past summer, you would have gone into stage four. So the wetland is very important for your water system and also in the bigger picture of the state of Texas. Before I get into the water issues, though, a lot of people come to the Wetland Center and they don't walk in and say, "Now, John, tell me everything you know about water conservation." They don't really care about water conservation, or maybe they do. But they want to hear about the eagles. They want to hear about the wildlife. And maybe you saw the eagles on the news. Our building, as I said earlier, is in the middle of this 2,000-acre wetland, and about a mile south, it's the south-facing part of the building that you see here, along the edge of the tree line, this beautiful sunset, you're probably wondering, why am I looking at transmission line towers? Did anybody see about our eagles on the news over the Christmas break? Well, about 3 years ago, a pair of American bald eagles decided to build their nest on the bottom arm of that transmission line tower. That transmission line tower, owned by Encore, brings 350,000 volts of electricity into southern Dallas. You can't have eagles on top of a tower, because if the eagles do waste or scat on the line, of course it could injure the bird or kill the bird, but also shut off power to southern Dallas. So about 3 years ago, we had been observing them, and a little over 2 years ago, we began a conversation with Encore Electric Delivery, Falcon Steel, which actually builds these structures, and the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service to relocate this American bald eagle nest. Pretty amazing process. Here's a couple of pictures from last year, and they are, a lot of people say, well, what kind of eagles are they? There's only two types of eagles in Northern America, the golden eagle and the American bald eagle. And they are making a comeback in the southern part of the U.S., but they happen to find our wetland. And the main reason that they are at our wetland is because a consistent water source and a consistent food source. And they found the highest point on the property and a perfect platform to build their nest. Unfortunately, we don't want them in that area, but they were very successful 2 summers ago, and they raised 2 eaglets. Now, in this photograph here, this was taken in June of 2013. The eaglets were not babies anymore, but they had fledged. And they're about 2 feet tall, the same size as their mother and father. And we caught this photograph as they were actually on the base of the tower around a pond. And once they fledged the nest, the mother and father actually teach them how to fish for the next 2 months. So one of our volunteers went in and captured this awesome photograph. You can see it has a little molting here on its chest, but not the white feathers yet. Usually between the third and fourth year, the eagles start to get the white feathers on their head and on their tail. And then we were going to move the tower, and as I say, there's plan A, plan B, but there's also plan eagle. And plan eagle is nature does what nature wants to do. Literally, we're sitting in a room with the president of Encore, president of Falcon, U.S. Fish and Wildlife, and they said, "John, what do you want us to do?" And I said, "I'd like for you to build a brand new tower that looks just like this one, 1,200 feet away. And I want you to relocate the nest without touching it or damaging it." And they said, okay. They partnered together, all of these organizations, and $150,000 later, we started this plan. So 2 summers ago, we started this, and we got our permit from U.S. Fish and Wildlife on August 25th. On September 1st, the eagles returned to the tower. So we couldn't touch the tower. So we ended up with a whole nother year of the eagles raising their young on that live transmission tower. And this is one of the juveniles from this past summer. Unlike the first set the year before, they like to stay around the tower all the way till June 23rd they stayed. Kind of like getting the kids to leave the house. These guys didn't want to leave. They would literally fly away from the tower and then come back to the nest every morning for mom to feed them. So we waited patiently, and then as soon as they left, the process went into place. And we built the new tower. The new tower actually here, which is about 1,200 feet away, the juveniles would actually play on the tower. They would fly over to the other one. It's in with sight distance of the old tower. And here they are returning early one morning. You can see the two juveniles waiting for mom, which is right here, to bring food back to them. So once they left, we started the process. And the first thing we did was to go up, and they took photographs inside the nest. You would think that it was soft and lined with feathers. It's not that at all. It's carnage. It's food. It's bones. These are bones of raccoons, skunks, not river otter, the American alligator, alligator gar, inside of their nest. Pretty much that is where they're feeding, inside the nest. So on the weekend of July 12th and 13th, they had a crew that went up and first secured the arm that they were going to unbolt with a large crane. And literally, if I didn't see this myself, they bubble wrap the nest. So they wrap bubble wrap around the nest and saran wrap. These contractors treated it as if it was their kids. And then they lowered that arm onto a flatbed truck, and it took the whole flatbed, as you can see, sort of the dismay on my face here. I was amazed by the size of the nest, 8 feet around, 2.5 feet deep, and over 250 pounds. And that was just 3 years of building. Those eagles, that same pair, will come back to that same location for the rest of their adult life. And the eagles are monogamous. Main reason is that the female is locked to the nest once she lays the eggs. So the male has to be committed to her in order to bring food back for her to survive. But the incubation duties are also shared. So the male and the female both share incubating the eggs. So we erected the arm. Actually, on the very next morning, we put the arm up on the tower, exactly the same direction it was faced, but 1,200 feet away. And then we waited. All summer went through. Around the beginning of September, they showed back up. And as I said earlier, there's plan A, plan B, and plan Eagle. Well, they went back to the old location, of course, because that's where they raised their young. It took the contractors a couple of weekends, and we removed sticks every time they put them there. Eventually, on October 1st, I saw them land on top of the tower. And then by October 15th and 16th, they were adding sticks to the nest in the new location. And right now, the tower is right on the edge of the wetland, looking out from the wetland center, still roughly about a mile away. And we actually installed a closed circuit camera. You can see sort of the signal that sends to the wetland center. But being 1 mile away from the wetland center and dependent on solar power, it's actually offline right now because we couldn't approach the tower after they started to lay their eggs. And here's a photograph we got while they were in the nest. Pretty cool. Once they came back, you can see how the nest has been built up. This is the female in the nest and the male sitting up here. The difference is the female is a little bit larger and has a longer tail, and you can see that when she's flying. And then this photograph was actually taken on February 7th. This is the female getting up off of the nest. The male has just flown back in, early morning light, and she's allowed to go for about 4 or 5 hours, and she stretches her wings, and he takes over incubation duties. So if all goes well, we should see signs of the juveniles in the next week or two. So keep a watch on our website. We update our website, which is wetlandcenter.com, and it's on the back of your brochure as well. And hopefully, we'll see if we have two eaglets at the end of this year. Here are all the partners that were involved in this, from Encore and Falcon to individuals that were observing the eagles to make sure when they were leaving the nest. We had to be very careful because we worked under a permit by the U.S. Fish and Wildlife. You know, when I think about these kind of partnerships, and I can't really describe it better than a friend of ours that was monitoring them. He said, you know, you have a man-made wetland, and you have a man-made tower, and you have nature-made eagles. These type of partnerships maybe could bring back a population of eagles like this. Even though they were removed from the endangered species list in 1987, they are still protected, and the Wetland Center has taken the responsibility to monitor them for the next 10 years. You know, it's amazing with this wetland here in the foreground that's supplying water to your community. And we think about water on the global scale, and we learned this when we were in fourth grade, right? How much of our earth is covered in water? 2/3, about 3/4, about 70 to 75% of our earth is covered in water. And this is the normal picture that we see. An actual great new photograph from the NASA Earth Observatory But if we were to take all the water on our Earth, in our lakes, rivers, streams, and the deepest part of the ocean, and put it in one sphere on top of our planet, that sphere would be about 839 miles in diameter. And would fit over the western part of the United States. This is all the water. When I show this image, a lot of people say, well, how can that be? The oceans must be very deep. Some of you probably drove here today, maybe about 4 to 6 miles. That's some of the deepest parts of our ocean. And if we were to take all the fresh water available at one moment in time in our rivers and our streams and our lakes, that ball would be about 169 miles of fresh water. Take the salt water out of it. Now, if we take the amount of water that's available at one moment in time for us to use in our water towers, in our reservoirs, and in the rivers that pass our communities, that ball of water would be about 69 miles in diameter and fit over the city of Atlanta, Georgia. That's for everyone on our planet. Of course, we know the water cycle, that water moves and changes, but doesn't that give you a little different perspective on the amount of water on our planet? So it's very important when we think about that water here in the state of Texas. I love Google Earth. I got this from Google Earth and geology.com, but showing a satellite image of our state. And if we look basically over the eastern part of our state, we can see all the reservoirs and the one natural lake. What is that one natural lake in our state? Caddo Lake, until about 1839. And then it was a log jam, and then they dammed it up. So it's partially man-made and partially natural. But there are over now 70 reservoirs in our state of Texas that bring water into our communities. In our region alone, which is called Region C, there are about 16 reservoirs that bring water from hundreds of miles away to 6.5 million people here in the Metroplex. A lot of the figures I'm using right now, if you're wondering where I got these from, they're from the Texas Water Development Board. They plan and they project population growth for our state for 50 years. Every 5 years they do this so the communities can plan for water development. There are 13 water regions in our state. We are Region C. And in our entire state right now, our population is at about 25.4 million, projected by the year 2060 to grow to 46 million people. Keeping up with the demand of water is very important. Actually, we measure water in what we call acre feet per year. An acre is the amount of land that one man or woman could plow in one day with one ox. That was the original measurement of an acre. Now, measure that 1 acre of land covered in 1 foot of water. That is an acre feet. And so in the state of Texas right now, we're using about 18 million acre feet of water a year. And by the year 2060, that population, as it grows, we need 22 million acre feet of water. But obviously, looking at this chart, the demand far outweighs the supply that we currently have. So the state of Texas, by the Water Development Board, leaves it up to each region to create their new sources of water or reallocate sources of water. So for our entire state, here's the 2012 water plan and reallocation of existing supplies. That means our neighbors, Dallas Water Utilities or Tarrant Regional Water District, or other parts of the state reallocating their supplies to our region. And North Texas Municipal Water District, which of course is your water district, is very, very hard working at reallocating those supplies. New major reservoir for the entire state, only 17%. It's not really high on the priority list for the entire state, but it definitely is for our region. You'll see that in just a moment. Groundwater, pretty minor at 9%. Other, which is other sources that we haven't identified yet. But these two are actually work in tandem with each other. 24% of future water use is by your conservation. You might have heard this statistic, but last summer, your region, Region C and North Texas Water District, conserved close to 35% more water than you did the previous summer. Very important. Your conservation efforts, along with the wetland, created and prevented us from going into stage 4. Very important. On average, the state of Texas uses about 90 gallons per person per day. Our region, about 120 gallons per person per day. So, reuse is the wetland center. the wetland project. So reuse projects of using water that you've already used for our future. To sort of give you the bird's eye view, when I talk about water districts, it's kind of hard to understand because if your neighbor across the street, I know Gail lives down in Richardson, and if she has a neighbor that lives in a different city, you might be saving or conserving water differently. That's because we have four major water districts. This is obviously your water district, the bright green one, which is North Texas Municipal Water. We have this large one here, south and north, which is Tarrant Regional Water. We have Dallas Water Utilities, which is Dallas proper and most of Dallas County. And then we have Upper Trinity Water District, which is up in Louisville and Grapevine. Each different district has claims to their own individual reservoirs, or they share water rights with those reservoirs. I'll give you an example. For us, you guys know Lavon Lake is your main reservoir, but there are pipelines that come from Jim Chapman, Lake Tawakoni, Lake Texoma, and the East Fork Wetland, which is right here. Those four major reservoirs bring water into your district. It's important that we keep those levels, and most of our reservoirs are what we call surface lakes. They might be 30 feet at their deepest. If you get further south in the state of Texas, you would find deeper reservoirs down near Austin. Dallas Water Utilities has Ray Hubbard, Lake Louisville, which used to be Lake Dallas, but was increased in size about 50 years ago, Lake Ray Roberts. They have half of the rights of Lake Grapevine. The other two cities that share water rights are the most wealthiest cities in our region, Highland Park and University Park. They share half of those water rights. And then there's Joe Pool Lake, which is shared by Tarrant. And then Tarrant Regional Water District, the newest reservoirs built in the state down here, in the 60s and 70s, Cedar Creek and Richland Chambers, Lake Bedenbrook, Lake Worth, Eagle Mountain, and Bridgeport. And then this one is shared. Upper Trinity Water District shares water with Dallas Water Utilities and also Tarrant Regional Water. So you can see there's a lot of efforts that go into bringing this water into your state. So if Dallas is not in stage three or not conserving water, now you see why. Their water is coming from a different source. I did leave out one, I forgot this. There's a large pipeline that comes from the Red River straight into Dallas. After the drought of the 1950s, that pipeline was put in place, so they're not taking water directly out of Texoma, but out of the river. So that keeps them from having to conserve as much water as we do in our region. Some quick facts about our entire region, which basically this is our whole region. It goes a little bit east right here. Our population, the total service area, to 13 million. Right now it's at about 6.7 million, but in 50 years it's going to grow to 13 million. North Texas, where we are, all these 13 member cities, including Frisco, Plano, Allen, and all those areas, 3.5 million by 2050. But look at our demands, measured again in acre feet per year. Total water demands right now, 1.7 million acre feet. In 50 years, 3.2 million. And here's a quick breakdown. Livestock remains about the same, county remains about the same, irrigation about the same, electricity does increase for water consumption, mining about the same, manufacturing increases, but here's the big one on the block, the one that we don't like to talk about that much, municipal water use. Your water district, North Texas, right now, is working at creating a new water source. Lower Bodart Creek Reservoir. Have you heard of this yet? So the next major reservoir in the state of Texas, and it's not that big, it's only 17,000 acres. It's not that large. But it would produce more water in a different watershed. This summer, actually, they are going through their permit process, and there are 11 landowners that are actually taking NTMWD to court because they're fighting for their land. I don't blame them. Dallas-Fort Worth wants their water in the east. Now, if one of my board members was here in the room, I might say the same thing, but we have to. We have to keep up with that demand. I think the challenge is how do we conserve what we have? How do we think outside the box? And the East Fork Wetland Project is exactly what your water district did. So we could prevent having to build a new reservoir till the year 2020, and that's when the new Lower Bardark Creek is supposed to come online. It's an important thing to talk about, but maybe over time, we could go the same way that Las Vegas in California did, where the water district actually gave them credits, or they gave them a refund if they took out their sod. Let's look at your cities. on this map. The 13 member cities here, this is what we call a five-year running average. We can see the high point of water usage around 2002. And this is per capita, gallons per capita, so your entire household, at about 275 gallons. And right now we've gone down to around 200, and your average right now, and this could be off, Gale, this is the running average, but not your current, 106, so residential. So differences of that municipal, all water usage is included in that, but residential is definitely different from it. So it shows you that this average is decreasing over time. So very good sign. Here in our region, and these are our new water supplies just in Region C. Major new reservoir, as I talked of earlier, 30% of our future. Other surface water means reallocating existing supplies from other surface water. Water utilities from Dallas, Dallas Water Utility, selling water to North Texas Municipal Water District is part of that. But here we are, the conservation and reuse, and this other, another 25% in our region alone. Just a quick reference back to this map in our region of North Texas Municipal Water District here, and I'm going to focus in now on the wetland project. And here are the pipelines. Our 72-inch pipeline from Texoma, our 7-foot pipeline from the wetland, and our 54-inch and 84-inch pipeline from Jim Chapman and Tewakini. Those are your major water sources coming in. And of course, you've probably heard about the extension of the Texoma pipeline due to the zebra mussel. $390 million worth of an extension of a pipeline. And what they did, the pipeline actually used to bring the water straight into what we call Sister Grove Creek, which brought in the possibility of the invasive zebra mussel into Lavon directly. Your water district and you paid for this extension of the pipeline that brought the pipeline all the way around the reservoir and brought it right about there. They built two 50 million gallon settling basins. Concrete lined, the water enters into these basins first, and the zebra mussels do not like soft substrate soil, they like hard surfaces, pipelines, concrete. So they sink to the bottom and they attach themselves to the bottom of these settling basins. Then the water is pulled from that settling basin down to your water treatment facility here in Wiley, and that water is mixed and blended with the water from Lavon Lake. So that water actually never enters the reservoir itself. So that's completely keeping the zebra mussels out of your reservoir. Right now we're mixing at a rate of 1 to 3. So one part from Texoma to about 3 parts Lavon. That hopefully will increase. As we're basically getting more water from Texoma now, it takes a little while to build up that water necessarily in the bank because we're not bringing the water in as fast as he were before. Yes, ma'am. What happens if all the lakes get zebra mussels? Good question. It could be a possibility. We haven't seen it spread in the major reservoirs in North Texas yet. It won't affect the quality of the lake itself, but will affect the infrastructure. That's the biggest concern. The dams, the pipes, and the concrete. But it is an issue, but the water district is definitely trying to think outside the box for that. And this is definitely thinking outside the box. The Wetland Center, as you see, is right here in north central Kaufman County. We're looking at the entire project. Photograph that was taken, we monitor the wetland actually every other month by helicopter to look at the growth rate and the movement of water through the wetland. It's an amazing project, and actually the original title of this and the legal title is the East Fork Raw Water Supply Project. So one of the first things I did as a director was to create exhibits. And I went to my board and I said, can I change the name just a little bit? You know, when I'm going out to the community and selling raw water, that doesn't sound as palatable as a wetland. So who wants to talk about raw water today? Doesn't sound as good. So the East Fork Wetland Project, created by this Partnership for Conservation, and North Texas had this vision that they got from Tarrant Regional Water District, our sister organization. They built a pilot wetland on Richland Chambers Reservoir of 400 acres. And they were designing this to filter already treated wastewater. It worked really well. They were filtering out mainly phosphate and nitrate. So North Texas heard about it and said, let's do this. Let's do it on a larger scale. So they got a water rights permit from the state of Texas to reclaim 100% of the treated wastewater. North Texas not only has water treatment facilities in Wiley, but they have 5 wastewater treatment plants throughout their member cities. So they got the permit to reclaim all of that water. If you mix and blend that with the regular flows coming down the Trinity, environmental flows from other streams, they can reclaim roughly 70% of the water coming down the East Fork of the Trinity River. So they got the water permit, but they needed a piece of land. They needed it south of all the wastewater treatment plants, but north of where the main stem joins the East Fork of the Trinity. So they looked all over the place, and just so happens, the community that's just south of the Wetland Center here, one of my board members, Mike Rickman, which is also works for North Texas Municipal Water District, knew about this property. And he knew it was owned by one family, Caroline Rose Hunt, and her son, John Bunker Sands. So they contacted the family, the Rosewood Corporation, and they said, not only will we partner with you to build this project, let's also build a nature center right in the middle of it and name it after her oldest son. And that's what created the East Fork Wetland Project and the John Bunker Sands Wetland Center. Actually, my board consists of 3 water district members. Of course, Tom Kula, the new executive director for North Texas Water District, Mike Rickman and Joe Farmer, and then 3 family members, Patrick Sands, which is Bunker's brother, his oldest son, Jacob, which is our board president, and also Wilson Sand, which is a nephew of Bunker's. Pretty amazing. And I love to talk about the land. I love to talk about the property. And if you go on Google Earth, one of my favorite things to do in my spare time, and if you go back in time, has anybody done this? You can go back in time on Google Earth and look at your piece of property as it was 20 years ago. So here's a photograph taken from, I believe this is 2001, about 16 years ago. The Wetland Center sits right about there. But this is when Bunker had the property. And the whole ranch actually spreads this whole area, about 5,000 acres total. Bunker was a conservationist, a lover of wetlands, and a lover of wildlife. And here's the modern wetland laid over the top, and you can sort of see this unique pattern in the wetland. And what we're looking at and what we can see, here's the East Fork of the Trinity River, is the old floodplain. 500 years ago, this would have been a bottomland hardwood forest. And of course, over the years, it was changed and used for farming. And before Bunker's family had it in the early 1950s, it was a cotton farm for the last 40, 50 years. So when he got the property, he focused on cattle grazing. He focused on holistic ranch management. Unfortunately, Bunker never saw this project to its fruition, because he passed away from pancreatic cancer in 2003. But he had an idea. He thought, maybe I could take part of my ranch and turn it into a wetland, a mitigation wetland, which basically offsets the impact of another wetland in the same watershed. This was 1992. He worked with an organization called Allen Plummer Associates and a specific scientist named Loretta Mokry. She developed a plan, and it looked remarkably similar to the wetland that we see nowadays, but he didn't want to build it to reuse the water. He just wanted to build it to filter the water before it went back into the Trinity River. One thing stood in his way, and I'm going to back up to show you this. Right here is an agricultural levee built in 1940 to prevent the river from flooding into what was a cotton farm at that time. So in order to have a mitigated wetland, you have to allow that river to flow in. So you can't dismantle the levee without an act of Congress. So the plan sat on a shelf, a lot of red tape. Time goes on, Bunker still works on the property. He puts in wood duck boxes, he puts in smaller wetlands, and he became very well known for this holistic approach, treating the ranch not just for cattle farming, but also for wildlife, that ranchers from around the state would come and hear about his project. And you can see it in this photograph, if you exactly know what you're looking at. Here is one of his original wetlands that he designed himself. You can see the levees that he put up. Here's another one on the edge of the property, and those two wetlands are now incorporated into the larger wetland. But what you can also see is this land is divided up into 80 to 100 acre segments. And so his cattle, instead of grazing the whole 1,000 acres at one time, every 7 to 10 days, he would rotate the cattle from one pasture to another. By the time that cattle returned to the original pasture they were in, 2 months later, that pasture had regrown with native plants. So he was treating the land in a very holistic approach. Little ahead of his time, I believe. And we look at the modern wetland. We don't have cattle rotating in the wetland, but we still have an active cattle ranch, and the cattle rotates around the wetland every 7 to 10 days. So if you were to come out and visit us, and you might have seen it when you were there, we have cattle on the property, the wetland working, and on the east side of the river right here, they built Bunker's reclaimed wetland. So Bunker now has his own wetland off to the side for mitigation. Pretty amazing. Well, the way this project works every day, as you can see, there was a lot that went into this as they planned this, but the important part was the source of water. Here are the six, this one is owned by the city of Dallas, six wastewater treatment plants. These four are the ones that we focus on. The one at Wilson Creek, since that water actually gets discharged directly into the reservoir, it goes under ultraviolet light as before it goes back into the reservoir. The ultraviolet light reduces the amount of phosphate and nitrate in the water column. These four water treatment plants, wastewater treatment plants, do not have that treatment. That's why we collect it down here in the wetland. So, every day, we divert roughly 50 million gallons of water into the wetland. For 1.7 million people, this water filters over 7 to 10 days. It's about 2,000 acres total. 1,840 of that is actually wet. The rest is levees that go in between. It's 3.5 miles roughly long, north to south, and over 1.5 miles wide. Pretty large piece of land. But how does this actually work? How do we get a wetland to work for us? Or as one of my board members said, man is helping nature to help man. We're diverting the water just north of Highway 175 here through what we call the intake structure. It's a concrete structure that sits right on the edge of the East Fork of the Trinity River, and there are four metal grates that prevent large pieces of wood or fish or basketballs or beach balls. You see it. We've seen it coming down the creek. And the engineers designed something unique. On the very top, it's called the Traveling Screen Trash Grabber. I just call it the claw. It's a little simpler. And every hour on the hour, it scrapes each one of those screens and it picks up any trash that's accumulated and it puts it in a pile right on the end of the structure. As the water flows in, there's a diversion pump station that has three 300 horsepower engines in it that pull that water in. Some days it might be 20 million gallons. Some days, if we get a lot of rain, it might be 100 million gallons. As that water is pulled in, the first thing it does, it goes into three sedimentation basins. They're roughly 12 acres large each and about 10 feet deep. The water sits in there for roughly 24 hours. That allows the silt, sand, and clay to sink to the bottom. And then from this point through the entire system, there's no other engines. There's no other pumps. All of it goes through gates. And if you look close, you can see them. The gate right here and right here and right here allows the water to flow into the first treatment cell, cells 1, 2, and 3. And between each wetland cell, there's what we call a weir. It's just a fancy gate that's been actually used since ancient times that allows the water to flow from one cell here to the cell behind where this gentleman is standing. And the way this weir works, every morning, five gentlemen go out and measure the depth of water in the wetland. And the optimum depth is only 4 inches to 18 inches deep. There's some deep water zones that allow more sediment to fall out, but let's say he needed 4 more inches of water to go in the cell behind him. He rotates this screw right here, and as it descends, it's measured in inches, and he can descend that screw, and this gate goes down 4 more inches in the water, so a 4-inch column of water comes over the top until it equals itself out, and then the water continues through. The water does not go through every wetland cell. There's 26 in all, but it goes through a series. Once it comes underneath the highway here, it comes into cells 4, 5, or 6. It takes roughly 3 to 4 days in this north section, and these 20 different species of native plants filter out that nitrate and phosphate. Because of course, if you're a plant lover, you know that's what their food is. So the wetland center is sitting right here, trying to give you a frame of reference. The water comes underneath this large berm, and remember that levee I was talking about? There it is. The water actually comes up to the edge of that levee, And that levee proved very important for this project because it prevents the river from flooding into the project. So if we're to ever get a high flood again, it would maintain the integrity of the entire wetland system. In the southern portion, the water doesn't flow north to south. It actually enters in and flows east to west. And right in front of the wetland center, we've created the wetland cells that support more habitat, a lot more diversity of plants and wildlife in those cells. This process that filters out that phosphate and nitrate is called phytoremediation. Phytoremediation, real fancy word that literally means plants restoring balance. It takes out the phosphate, nitrate, and ammonia and reduces that. 7 to 10 days later, the water exits each one of these cells and ends up in this channel into the storage pond. And sitting on the edge of that storage pond is this conveyance pump station. Inside that building, there's 3,000 horsepower engines that push the water through a 7-foot diameter pipe for 43 miles underground. That water travels roughly 18 hours later. That water ends back in Levon Lake. This is about a mile and a half north of the dam. The water flows back into the reservoir. This was about 2 years ago, but the water level right now is right about there. But we can see the improved water quality. Right now, reducing phosphate by about 75%, nitrate by 65%, and suspended solids, what makes that river look like milkshake, about 45%. And the benefit of that is it reduces the amount of algae that would bloom in the reservoir, creating a more healthy ecosystem. We can only return at the high point 30% of the water that you use. Only 30%. And the reason why, I'll show you this. Right now, Levon Lake yields 104,000 acre feet per year. The East Fork Wetland Project, as your population grows, unlike a reservoir, is pretty static. We can increase the amount of water we bring into the wetland. Because the way the water rights permit is written, we can reclaim all that treated wastewater. So the more you use and the more the population grows, the more water we can bring in. So by the year 2030, we're going to bring in about 102,000 acre feet of water a year. But look at the footprint. The wetland is about 1/10 the size of Levon Lake and has a tremendous impact. The reason we can't return more than 30% of your treated wastewater is what we call unknown constituents of concern. Pharmaceuticals, emerging drugs that are in our system, the EPA regulates that, so we don't want to use that water over and over again. So we're capped right now at 30%. This past summer was about 25% that we returned back to the reservoir. And how did the wetland start? How did we actually construct it? Most of what was constructed in the wetland was just on site. So the levees and the berms built between each wetland cell was actually dug out from what was already on site. Being an old cotton field, there was a lot of real thick Trinity River clay, and that was used to line the wetland. Not very porous, so not a lot of water infiltrates through that clay. They didn't bring really any dirt in for that. So the earth that was moved on site created all the levees. The plants that were actually used on site were originally brought from the stock of bunkers plants. We did have to purchase additional plants. The plants that are mainly in the wetland are all native. The workhorse of the wetland is what we call giant bulrush. Giant bulrush is pretty much a monoculture here in the north central section. We also have cattail, which actually filters out quite a bit as well. But there are about 20 different species of plants, depending on the water level, depending on how deep it is the type of species that we plant. When Bunker was young, when he was in his 20s and 30s, he spent a lot of time traveling. And he traveled to Africa. He traveled pretty much throughout the world. And he was in Africa in the mid-80s. He was looking at holistic ranch management. And he learned that from a gentleman named Alan Savory, or Alan Savoy, depending on how you pronounce his name. He's what we call the father of holistic management. And he was in Africa, Alan, and was practicing this rotation of crops and rotation of cattle. And so Bunker learned from him. And when he came back to the US, he actually invited Alan to his farm and said, can you come and teach me how to do this? And so he learned it from someone on site. He didn't actually go to school. He went to school to be a business person. And then he worked with other ranchers and other farmers, and it just spread that way. They designed it in threes. The reason is that they can shut down one of the said basins or one of the cells in a train at a time, drain it. So let's say every 5 to 10 years we're supposed to drain the said basins and pull the sediment out. We would drain one, the other two would still operate, go in, pull out the sediment. They will test the sediment at that point to see if there's any high levels of heavy metals. If there's high levels of heavy metals, it will be put in landfills. If not, our goal is to actually sell that as fertilizer. This wetland, very important. And if we're looking at the south-facing side of the building, one thing they did before they flooded the wetland was built this massive boardwalk. The board, as I mentioned earlier, had an amazing vision. And their mission is pretty succinct. The mission that we fulfill is to educate the public and provide research opportunities in three main areas. Obviously, wetlands, water quality and supply, and wildlife management. Because we're actually managing the property for those three things. The very first year or so, I was so focused on the wildlife, I sort of let the water issue sort of filter into the background. But that is the number one reason that we're there. And we wouldn't have this amazing habitat without this water system. So if you do come out and explore our massive boardwalks, about a little over half a mile that goes into deep water zones and shallow water zones, it gives the public an opportunity to examine the plants up close. And of course, our researchers and our school students that are our main focus, it gives an opportunity to really interact with the wetland in a close-up scale. Our three main tenets, obviously, education and research and conservation. We try to use everything we can to show conservation in the wetland, including that bright blue barrel in the middle of the picture. Obviously, a rain barrel. I figured Gail might like that. Rain barrel in the middle here, and people say, well, why is that water barrel there? But the building, the original design was supposed to be a LEED certified building, cost millions of dollars. We threw that plan away, and we created a building that was a lighter footprint on the land, and we included things that were possible for a LEED certified building, like bamboo flooring, big overhang over here so we could prevent the sun from coming in, but we have it opened up right here, so as the sun drops low in the horizon in the winter, it can warm up that large gallery space. But every student that comes here, we mainly focus on fourth grade through high school. Our 50% of our programming the past year and a half has been middle school and high school. We don't call them field trips, we call them field studies, because the students are introduced to possibly a career or possibly how a researcher could do something. So it could be a fourth grade group that gets off the bus, and this is one of my favorite activities. It's hard to tell, but they're standing around the shape of a rope in the shape of Texas. And they're standing around the edge, and we're talking about what makes a wetland, plants, water, and soil, and then they choose to be a certain type of animal. And they enter the state of Texas, and then we destroy the wetlands by hurricane, or high salinity, or fire, or building. And we pull the rope around their feet, and as the wetland shrinks and the state shrinks, they shrink up into the middle. So you got kids pushing on each other and yelling. But it gives them an idea of what would it be like if you actually lost your habitat. I've even done this with adults, and I've had some adults walk away from it crying, saying, I've never thought about it that way. I've never thought about the habitat for the wildlife. With the high school students, we sent them out on the boardwalk first. This looks like a staged picture, but it is not. The high school students, when we go out into a field study, our number one program is called Wetland Ecology, where the students are divided up into roughly six teams. It's about 4 to 5 students in each team, and they go out and collect macroinvertebrates, aquatic insects in the water column. And we can tell just by looking at the bugs how healthy the water is, by what's present and by what's absent. So we just saw leeches, we would know the water quality wasn't very healthy. Of course, we know the wetland is doing its job very well, but the students don't know that yet. So they could collect a water sample and smell it. This guy literally is smelling the water, wafting it, smells for odor in the water or the color of the water itself. This girl has just collected a soil sample, but she's got something on her foot there, I'm not sure. And then we have a data collector. So we have water sample, soil sample, we even look at the plants. And then all that data is brought back into the building, and then the students do a comparison between one wetland cell and the other. And then they sort of judge which wetland cell looked better, which one had more plants in it. And some of the exact data that we're gathering, we give to Loretta. And Loretta uses it to help determine more specifically how the wetland is operating. It could even be a lab study. And in this photograph, these students are doing a plant press in our plant ecology class. So not only are we giving students real applications of what they would learn in high school, but they could actually do this one day. This could be a job for them as an ecologist. And then, of course, our research. Research on the property, the vision of the board is to do multi-year research. Right now, we're working with mainly graduate students, but some pretty fantastic research projects. The first one we did in 2011 and 12 was refining the hydraulic budget. What that means is we knew how much water was coming in, about 50 million gallons average, and we knew how much water was going out, so we know we're losing something through transpiration or through evaporation. And Laura Foss, right outside of the picture here, she didn't want me to use her face in the picture, so I just used her glasses. She determined we're losing 10 to 12 million gallons a day in one day, mainly through evapotranspiration out of the wetland. The plants do keep that a little bit lower, but mainly for evapotranspiration. And then our last research project, also at Baylor University, Avi and her research partner Preston were looking at the heavy metal accumulations in the wetland. North Texas Municipal Water District wants to know this now. So when we are able to use that sediment, and what she's finding in her preliminary results is very little accumulation of heavy metals in the entire wetland system, which is actually really good news. And our current research project, my favorite, any snake lovers in the group? Definitely. So University of Texas at Tyler is doing something pretty amazing. We have a new habitat. This habitat's never been there. It's been there 5 years. A baseline survey. Snakes, fish, mussels, crawfish, and amphibians is what we're looking at. We've already identified 9 snake species in the wetland and around the edges of it. Pretty amazing. The great thing about this project is that it's going to give us a base for if another organization or another state wants to do something similar, how would they manage it for wildlife? Tarrant Regional Water District, as I mentioned earlier, had that 400-acre wetland. They just expanded that to 2,000 acres. Theirs is a little bit different because they've actually worked with Texas Parks and Wildlife, and they have a wildlife management plan on the property. I'm working with our board of directors and other landowners to help create a wildlife management project on our property as well. But we are looking for new research. We're about to update our website. We went through a research horizon planning to look at research into the future. And what the board wants us to look at is mainly how can we increase removing phosphate in the wetland? How can we maybe sell some of this wetland soil? Could we do that? Could we mine it and use that? Also, the bird species. How could we increase habitat? And speaking of birds, there's over 257 bird species in our wetland. This is an awesome picture by one of our local visitors. She comes in with her little girl. She's about 6 years old now. This is taken about 3 years ago. But that gets most of our attention. The wildlife in the wetland is phenomenal. The birds do get a lot of attention, and rightly so. I know I've got some bird lovers in the group, I'm sure. Anybody know what this waterfowl is? Yes, wood duck. Wood duck family on the property taken a couple of years ago. What about these guys? Green winged teal and a green heron in the background. You'll see scenes like this in the wetland where you have two or three different species in one area. Or some unusual sightings like the yellow-headed blackbird. As they migrate through in the springtime with the red-winged blackbird, once in a while you'll see this yellow-headed blackbird appear. Or the snow geese in the fall migrations call our wetland home. I'm not just saying a couple of hundred, but thousands of them. They roost and spend the night in our wetland by 9,000 to 10,000 individuals. They go out in the farmer's field during the day and eat the seed they planted, and then they return back to our wetland to hang out. But pretty amazing to see them lift off at sunrise. Of course, pelicans. Pelicans are pretty much residential in our wetland now, but beautiful bird to see flying over. Or it could be a sort of a hodgepodge. We have our great white egrets and our pelicans and our snow geese in this picture here, an early photograph of the wetland. The birds get a lot of attention, but I love the furry animals too, the mammals. Obviously, bobcats, they think we built the boardwalk for them. The idea was this boardwalk would go out and prevent, you know, wildlife from getting to certain areas, but they just use the boardwalk. So every turn in the boardwalk, you're going to see piles of scat and waste. But this was a family that actually found their home here, male and female. And last year, these photographs were taken. This little cub here in the grass by one of our volunteers, Bill Nance. Pretty amazing. We'll see the bobcats either early in the morning on the boardwalk before the students get there, or late in the afternoon as they're leaving. Pretty cool. I love this photograph. It's my screensaver. He must have heard the shutter on the trail cam because it's just a motion-sensitive camera, and turned and got this awesome photograph of this bobcat looking in. I'm going to circle back to where I started because when we think about the population of wildlife on the wetland and how amazing that story that I started with about the preservation and protection of their habitat. And this photograph was taken from this last year. This is probably late February when we just start to see the eaglets peeking their head over the nest. You know, it's pretty amazing that we can look at a partnership that moved this nest, but under the umbrella of this much larger partnership of protection of habitat and for water resources. Focus on our water quality. The amazing focus this wetland has to bring water to your community has also provided all of these other benefits, from outreach like today to our research and education opportunities and our conservation of green space, as we know is very well needed in our metroplex. What other ways could we create these sustainable solutions? This is one example, especially for our water and wildlife. What do we do next? I was going to share with you one quick example I do at my house. You know, we all take showers, hopefully, or baths, and when I run the water, all that water goes down the drain, so I've been putting a bucket in my shower, collecting that water as the water warms up, and then the cat drinks out of that bucket. That's not going to use all of it, and then I pour the rest in the swimming pool. Yes. Yeah, or water the plants with it. But is that really going to solve the issue? It could. I'd love for you to come out and visit us. We're right across the Kaufman County line. As you exit and come down through the rest of Dallas County, once you cross the Kaufman County line, we're the very first exit. It's FM 1389 going towards a community called Combine. Don't follow your GPS unit. It will lead you to a closed gate right there because there was an old road. Follow the sign or the direction there and take that first right as you exit. And then you're going to go down about 2 miles and you'll see Martin Lane there on the left. We do have a little unusual hours. Mainly public programming for school kids and visitors just like yourself. We do a lot of school students during the week, Tuesday through Friday, 9 to 4. If you want to come out and visit us during the week, just give us a call ahead of time. Sometimes we're not there on the property. There's only 4 staff members on site, and sometimes we're off site. But then we're also open on the first and third Saturdays. You don't have to call or anything. First and third Saturdays of each month. You can reach us directly here or my email address there at the very bottom. Wetlandcenter.com or jdefillipo at wetlandcenter.com. You guys had a wonderful time presenting. I'm so glad you came out this afternoon. Thank you. Thank you very much.